Welcome back. I now request Professor Balasubramanian, our director, to say a few words.
Dear friends, let me welcome you for this workshop. And probably for most of you, this might be your first visit to this institute. And you might not have even known such an institute exists. Okay? Therefore, I should say something about this institute and then say something about these activities which are going on. This institute was started as a research institute in 1962 by Alladi Ramakrishnan. Therefore, we celebrated the Golden Jubilee this January. And around 1980s, it was taken over completely by the Department of Atomic Energy. And of course, some of you might be wondering, what is this atomic energy doing in this, which I will come a little later. The institute is mainly interested in research in mathematics, theoretical physics, and theoretical computer science. We do not have the laboratory facilities. These are the three departments that we have. And therefore, our job is essentially, our main mandate is essentially to do research and take students for PhD and train them for PhD. That's a mandate. Now, coming to the question of what is it that this institute has, what is it Department of Atomic Energy has with all these things, is that when the department started, long back, around 1960s, the Homi Bhabha, who was the founder of the atomic programs in India, felt that the nuclear sciences alone cannot grow as an oasis in a desert, and it's rather important that the department supports all the basic sciences. Therefore, only in the milieu of the basic sciences, the things would develop. And it is with this aim that the department has been supporting all basic sciences, including mathematics, physics, chemistry, biology, and everything that is needed, and cancer research, so on. And for mathematics, of course, they have a special board called the National Board for Higher Mathematics, which is under the DAE. And as you, most of you might have known, the development of higher science is entrusted to the Department of Science and Technology. But of all the sciences, mathematics and the nuclear sciences, the development of higher mathematics and nuclear sciences have been entrusted to the Department of Atomic Energy. The DST takes care of the development of other basic sciences. This is about the institute. Now, besides this mandate, it has all along been felt by my colleagues, essentially from the inception of this institute, or at least I have a first-hand knowledge after I joined this institute, that is from the mid-80s, that this institute should also play a role in developing mathematics, in fostering mathematics in the near colleges and the high schools, whatever, in whichever way this institute can do. And this has been one of our, even though it is not our mandate as such, this we have been doing rather successfully. And this remained essentially as an individualistic passion for a long time. Here, for example, Professor Parameshwar Shankaran and Professor Raghavan have visited many colleges and high schools and have given lectures to the students there. And there's a colleague of mine by name Professor Ramanujan in computer science, who has really taken a strong lead in interacting with the college teachers and high school teachers and see whatever that he could do. And therefore, this has been one of our strengths. Our outreach program has been one of our strengths of interacting with the students, going to their places, interacting with those teachers. If whenever anybody arranges a meeting or a workshop for the teachers in participating in that. And I think some of my colleagues also have played some role in the syllabus formation of the high school level and the college level and so on. Therefore, in whatever capacity that people could do, we have been always playing such a role. But this role so far has been confined to something an individual does out of his own interest. I mean, it was not an institute activity as such. But then when we celebrated the Golden Jubilee in 2013, and therefore when we were planning for it for the last 1 year, we decided that a certain programs which the members of the institute, the faculty of the institutes are doing on their own, which are good programs, then probably should be done as in the program of the institute. The institute should play a role, which means that the institute itself conducts a workshop for the students, conducts workshop for the college teachers, and these are the various things. And of course, we have other programs also of something called an associate and some visiting students programs and so on and so forth, which are for PhD students and university teachers who are doing research and so on. Therefore, this is in this particular connection that we are having this workshop. This is the second workshop, because this is something, I mean, from the institute level, even though as an individualistic level we have been doing it for the last 20 years, but from the institute level this is the second year we are doing it. And I should really appreciate my colleagues, Paramesh Shankaran and Raghavan, for having taken this initiative, and Vishwanath, yeah, this is a, and for having taken this initiative, I have assembled all of you and doing this good job. And let's give a big hand to them. I hope you would enjoy your stay here. And they have also got a few people, some of my other colleagues should be giving lectures here, like Professor Keshwan, and they also have got people from outside, Professor Surya Ramana from Allahabad, and various other people to get, she's there from Delhi to give the same, which will be the next lecture that would be given. And therefore, not only the institute, our institute members are involved, but on the other hand, we have also got experts from outside to give these lectures. And I hope that you would be enjoying these 2 days. And you should assume that the contact which you have with this institute is just not for these 2 days. And it should be a starting of your contact with this institute. And in whichever way this institute would be able to play any role whatsoever in interacting with you, in helping you to teach better, this institute will always strive its best to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Balu. I now request Jonaki Ghosh to give her presentation.
Very good morning. First of all, I would like to thank IMSC and Professor Parameshwaran and Professor Vishwanath for inviting me here. It is always a pleasure to come and interact with teachers, and presently I am teaching in the University of Delhi at the Lady Shri Ram College. I am actually teaching in the Department of Education. I teach mathematics in the Department of Education. So I am more of teaching pedagogy of mathematics rather than pure mathematics itself. But I've been a school teacher for a fairly long time, and I really feel that there are many concerns and issues that teachers face in the classroom. And my interest is how to help teachers or share some ideas with teachers. So when it was being discussed what I should talk about, I was suggested to focus on pedagogy. And I decided to choose the topic of calculus, developing students' thinking in calculus, and how technology can help in enhancing visual understanding. So this is the title, Developing Students' Thinking in Calculus, Possibilities Offered by Technology. So just to share the outline of the talk, first I will do a very brief overview of the senior secondary mathematics curriculum and what the National Curriculum Framework 2005 recommends. Then a little bit about the role of technology in mathematics learning, the research studies across the world, what do they say? What are students' understandings and misconceptions about the fundamental concepts of limits, derivatives, chain rule, integrals, fundamental theorem of calculus? This is all covered in 11th and 12th. And perhaps suggest, or maybe you could share some strategies for enhancing students' thinking through the use of some of the tools which are available. And if time permits, share an instance of a project which was explored by one of the students, where the student exploited the use of a particular tool to get visual understanding and access mathematics far beyond the level of class 12 actually. So we all know that the senior secondary stage is a significant landmark in the life of a student, as it leads to certification by the national or state boards. It's extremely high-stake examination, and in fact the NCF 2005 says that it is the launching pad from which the student is guided towards making career choices. So we all know that mathematics teaching at this stage is largely driven by preparation for these school leaving examinations and also the entrance examinations to various reputed institutes. And if you look at the topics, all of you are familiar with the topics of 11th and 12th, there are a few more topics in 11th, and many of these are prerequisite for the topics of class 12. 50% of the syllabus of class 12 is, around 50% is calculus. So, but when we are teaching these topics, what is the pedagogy that is really followed? It is the manipulative and computational aspects of these topics rather than applications which are emphasized. So there are very few opportunities in the class, and time is always a constraint, of course, for visualization, exploration, discovery, and there is practically no use of technology. In fact, if you look at the National Curriculum Framework and its impact on the mathematics curriculum, there has been a significant impact in the primary and the middle school, but very little has really happened in the senior secondary level. And if you really see the textbooks of the last 25 years, you will see that the approach to the topics haven't really changed much. Do you agree with me, or am I? And you will, if you study, I mean, I did a survey of the textbooks for the last 25 years. Some problems, especially in certain topics, the same problem has been coming year after year after year. Now, for example, this particular question, it has come in the examination also. It would come in the CBSE examination for 6 marks. So this kind of, this is the extent of modeling that a student is required to do, where the student will have to write out the volume function and do it. I'll come back to this question later. I'm just citing some examples from the NCERT textbook. There could be questions, the top one typically, which is based on just applying a formula and getting the answer, this would come for 2 marks. And some questions would require a fair amount of manipulative skill. For example, if you had asked them to integrate root tan x. So what are we emphasizing? Are we emphasizing on drill and practice and learning tricks to solve questions? Is that what we are teaching at the senior secondary level? Getting exact answers is also overemphasized in general. I'm not talking only of senior secondary, but in general. So again, the NCF says that we need to liberate school mathematics from the tyranny of the one right answer found by applying the one algorithm taught. And who are the stakeholders here? The students. So they ask, why do we need to study this? So there's also a recommendation that the use of real-world applications and modeling in dealing with concepts in various topics should become a part of the curriculum, so the student sees mathematics as something relevant to everyday life. And then there is a very important thing that the document says, that is, there should be a shift from content to processes. So there's nothing wrong with the topics or the content as it exists. But when we transact that content, can we focus a little more on the processes of learning mathematics, that is abstraction, estimation, approximation, generalization, use of patterns, all these things? Can we really ensure that these things happen? And if we are focusing on procedural knowledge, that is methods and rules, we also want to develop conceptual knowledge, and we can't think of the two as separate. We have to really think of a blend of these two. Now, in the last three decades, there have been many technology tools which have come about in the world, okay, across in many countries. And many learning theories have emerged due to the presence of these tools. And some of these are considered to be landmark studies. And if you really explore the landscape of research in mathematics education related to the use of technology, one study which stands out was done by Kathleen Hyde in 1988, which was basically to do with the teaching of a calculus, first year calculus course, taken up by students from various disciplines. And so this was usually, it was taught, that course was taught in a very traditional manner. What she tried was what is known as a typically used in the math education literature as the concepts first approach. So students were given various tools, some computer algebra systems and some graphing tools, to explore the concepts extensively, and the procedural aspects were only left to the end of the course. And in a sense, the course, the way the course was taught was resequenced. So then there was an experimental and a control group. So the students who underwent the resequenced course, actually it was found, outperformed the control group at the end when they were given a test or an examination. So on conceptual tasks, the experimental group outperformed the control group. And on the procedural tasks, they did almost as well. So the result was that there was no compromise on the by-hand skills or the procedural skills also of these students, in spite of the fact that they extensively used the technology tools. Now, of course, there could be critiques of this, that Kathleen Hyde herself was the one who designed the course, and she had a very extensive understanding of these, the limitations and the possibilities of those tools. And so would any other person transacting the course achieve the same results? We don't know that. But at that time, this was a very landmark study in this. And many other theories are there. It's not possible in a short time to list them out and share what they say. But probably technology plays a role in the following ways. Firstly, it enhances the, supports the constructivist approach. So the student can explore by herself and come up with, construct her own images of the ideas of the concepts. And if the explorations are designed in a proper manner, technology can also act as a scaffolding tool. So for a while, maybe some part of the procedural aspect can be outsourced to a technology, and the student can focus more on the conceptual aspect. So it lightens technical work and reduces cognitive load in the mind of the student. Technology also helps in the multi-representational understanding. So, you know, if you're exploring functions, you can explore functions symbolically, numerically, graphically, and so on. And because the tools are powerful and they can do many things, things which are not possible at that stage to do by paper and pencil, sometimes it is possible to give students access to higher level processes also. And of course, it is possible to include mathematical modeling explorations in the curriculum, because if technology is available. So these are some of the literature says that. And now, if you really look at the various kinds of tools which are available for mathematics instruction, and we can categorize them in four broad areas. One is the dynamic geometry software. With the many that are listed, the ones in blue are the open source and the others are not. So this, I'll be showing something on GeoGebra which soon. Handheld tools, of course, are graphics calculators or other kinds of calculators, which are fairly, they are fairly, have very good features, and they can, you can do many things with them. Computer algebra systems are also there, which can symbolically manipulate expressions. So if you give a integral, it will actually give you the answer. So in the presence of such a tool, what mathematics then needs to be taught in the class? And of course, there are spreadsheets as well. So these are the broad category of tools available. And see, every tool will have some positive and some limitations. If you look at graphics calculators, they are not as good, the graphs they produce and the screen outputs are not as sophisticated as other software packages. But they do bring the, to some extent, the power of visualization right onto the palm of the hand. And in a large classroom of 50 students, it is possible to take a set of calculators and distribute and make students work if it's not possible to take them to a computer lab. They can explore, you can explore functions on them, you can do statistical inference, you can multiply matrices. So a lot of things at the 11, 12 level are very much possible on a graphics, handheld graphics calculator. Computer algebra systems, of course, very sophisticated, they are powerful, and for school use, maybe to some extent they can be used for exploring projects which are spread over a longer period of time, perhaps not on a day-to-day classroom use. And spreadsheets are useful for simulation activities and looking at multiple simple regression, simple and multiple regression, and statistical inference and other things. Now, today's thing was about calculus and how technology can help in visualizing certain ideas and concepts. What should be the objective of a calculus course at the senior secondary level? So perhaps it is to develop students' understanding of the basic concepts, provide experience with the methods and applications, and develop some computational competence. I mean, that is also important. So how can the technology help? It should help to reinforce relationships among the multiple representations of functions. Students can use it to confirm written work. Now, in many of my experience of use of technology, students wanted to do things by hand, but they used a computer algebra system to check. Suppose it was a complicated integral. They solved by hand, and then they used a tool to check the answer, but the answer given by the tool was slightly different. So then they started to compare, how was that different and why was that different? And I thought a lot of mathematical thinking did go about even in that. And of course, they should be able to experiment, so you can change the coefficients of a function and see how does the shape of the graph change, and to assist in interpreting results. So these could be some of the ways in which technology can help. Now, if you start with limits, do you feel your students have problem in understanding the idea of limit? And when they encounter the formal definition at the college level, there is always a dissonance there, and college teachers also say that. And so these are some of the, when you talk to students about limits, these are some of the things they say. Function can never reach its limit. It can come really, really close to the limit, but never reach it. Other metaphors they use are tending to, going on forever. And in fact, David Toll did a research study which revealed cognitive conflict in the mind of students when it was asked whether the infinitely repeating decimal is equal to 1 or not. And students said 0.9 is equal to 1 or not. And students said the processes of adding 9, these are quotes from actual students, what they said. The processes of adding 9s to decimal representation never ends, gets closer to 1 but never reaches. How can two representations denote the same number, and so on. So Wiener and Toll together had done a lot of research on what they distinguish between what is known as a concept image and a concept definition. So what is the definition of a concept for any concept? Well, the words that are actually used to describe that concept, right? But the concept image, according to Wiener and Toll, is basically the entire cognitive structure. So basically all the mental pictures that a person develops when they think about a concept. And very often there is a conflict there. I mean, obviously the concept image is not the same as the desired concept definition. So in fact, in understanding the idea of limit, it involves a construction process. So instead of saying that student is having a wrong concept image, what we should do as teachers is to build on that concept image and see how we can reinforce it through different strategies. Perhaps the multi-representational strategy which technology affords us with is a good approach, where instead of beginning with the formal definition of limit, we should help students develop an intuitive understanding of the limiting process. Calculate limits using algebra, because that is anyway a part of the paper pencil procedure that they have to do, and estimate limits from graphs generated and maybe tables of data and so on. So technology should be used, could be used to explore the limits numerically, graphically and symbolically using various tools which are now in existence. Now these are again taken from the textbook. So typically how would your students approach, let's say, the first one? Yes, and then they would algebraically solve it and okay. And also for the, what about the third one? Yes, and how do you address the second one? In the class, do you deal with this or it's there in the textbook also, right? Sorry? Oh, sorry, yeah, yeah, sorry. Please ignore that, that's X, yes. Okay, so suppose like this is a tool, this is a kind of a handheld tool which is also has a computer. I was telling you about dynamic geometry and CAS. CAS is computer algebra systems. So these are tools which can symbolically manipulate. So this is a calculator which has a CAS in it, inbuilt in it. Now many countries do not allow the use of CAS enabled calculators in their examinations, but regular graphic calculators are allowed for use in examinations. Anyway, so in this, the first one, so they can enter the expression and they can simply graph it on the graphing screen in a small interval around 2, because they have to evaluate x limit of x approaching 2. And by doing that, they can also trace the cursor on the graph. As x approaches 2 from either side, what value is the function approaching? Same thing can be done numerically also. So they generate a table of values, and so here the x values, initially they took as 0.1 as the step size, and then they reduced the step size to 0.. These are still shots, of course. And then so they see that as x is approaching 2, the function value is approaching what? Though the function is not defined at x equal to 2. So it is approaching from either side, and you can further reduce the step size and make x come closer and closer to 2. And of course, because it has a limit command input in it, so you can also, so they can confirm their conjecture by evaluating it. So I'm not saying that they should not do it by hand, they should. But this helps them to see three representations of the same thing. For limit of sine 1 upon x, so they can, you can actually graph, you can graph the function and zoom in. There's a zooming in feature, so you can keep on zooming in at x equal, at the origin, and keep seeing that the oscillations are getting, they are not really going away and they're getting very pronounced. If you look at the third one, you can graph it again in a small interval around x equal to 0, and you can take the cursor, this is a cursor, so wherever the cursor moves on the screen, you get to see the x and y coordinates also. So you can read off the values, a value of the function as x is approaching a certain value. So that is a, so I have actually taken the screenshots of the graphics calculator. So this is a regular graphics calculator, and what you saw here is a CAS enabled handheld calculator. This is of course more advanced and sophisticated. But there are schools which do use these tools. So in a particular exercise, we said, okay, let the students try out different limits from the textbooks, and they drew the graphs and they tried to conjecture what the limits would be, will they exist or not, and so on and so forth. So I'm not getting into each and every question, but this is a activity sheet was given to the students, and this is what, so they even looked at things like this and sine x upon x square and so on. So if you were to be, if this was the kind of a question, how would your students approach this? Or what do you think is the limit of this, this limit? So out of the options, A, B, C, D, E. Any thoughts? You can work it out. But suppose I were to put this on a graphic calculator screen. So I would simply put the expression in the screen and I would just say graph the function. So let's see what the graph looks like. But I have to see what as limit as x approaches infinity. So now the student said that look, this is not going to help me. So I need to look further beyond on the x-axis and see what is happening. So the view window of the axis, the x and y axis was changed. And so here if you see the y value is being, if you read off the y value, what is it? Minus 0.25 something. So they actually could conjecture. So the tool at least helps you to conjecture the limit. Of course, algebraically also they should be able to solve this. Or if you ask them, so graphical reasoning, to enhance graphical reasoning, do you ask questions like this to students? You do. So what is the graph of fx is shown, the limit exists and f is not continuous at b, then b is equal to? B will be equal to what? It says the limit exists, but f is not continuous at B. What should be the value of B? At 2? The function is not continuous, but the limit exists. Which point would you say? What about this at 0? Does the limit exist at 0? Yes? But what is the value of the function? What does this dot indicate? So there's a hole in the graph, right? So these are the things we should bring out in the class. If you come to derivatives, for example, if you ask a student what is define the derivative, so they will use rate of change as an expression to describe the derivative. But very often they cannot distinguish between the average rate and the rate of change at a given point. So if you, instead of computing f of b minus f of a upon b minus a over an interval, they might just compute derivatives at various points and divide by the number of points. So these are some of the mistakes actually students do make. And if you ask them to describe, they will say that a derivative is a rate of change. They will talk about the gradual collapse of the triangle showing the slope of the secant line to a graph. They'll talk of series of secant lines which approximate tangent to a curve. And there's a secant, the secants collapse into a tangent. So these are the some of the, they use the word collapse a lot when describing these. Now, suppose you want students to explore the graphical representations of functions, tangent lines and secants, and that will develop flexibility in their thinking. But we do also make students do this definition, right? What do you call this definition of the derivative? First principles, and they evaluate this for many such functions, right? So maybe one way to visualize is what happens as h tends to 0 is if you just go to this, I'm opening a GeoGebra file. So this is sine 2x, the graph of sine 2x, and I am taking h. So I have, I would graph the derivative f dash x and also f of x plus h minus fx upon h and see what happens as h tends to 0. So when I graph the derivative, it is the red graph. And if you look at gx, we can't say gx because right now h is 0. Now as I change, so if you really move from far away, so as h approaches 0, then we see that this gx comes closer and closer to f dash x from either side, you can see that. And of course, you can change your, now you can just go and change your sign 2x by right clicking, and there is an option to change the graph. So quickly you can give a set of 5 or 6 functions and make the, so this, it just takes not even 2 minutes to create this in GeoGebra. Also the idea of local linearity. So if you, because the zooming in feature is there in most tools, we can actually, so for example, if you look at the function here, x cubed minus x, at a particular point, there has, the tangent has been drawn. So you can zoom in at this point repeatedly, and soon you will see that, what does this indicate? That the tangent and the curve are very, very close to each other in that small interval around the given point. So this also helps to understand the idea of local linearity, and the zooming in feature is a very useful approach. Another approach could be that you have a function and you draw tangents at different points and look at the slope of the tangent. So here the tangents have been drawn, and you note that this is whenever you take a cursor on a particular tangent, you will get to see the equation of the tangent. And this is of course a simple, this is just the y is equal to x square. So they can read off the slope and compare it with the x coordinates. As the cursor moves along the different tangents, they can see what the slope of the tangent is vis-a-vis the x coordinate. And also a table of values of the x and y, f dash x can be generated, and this would help to conjecture the derivative. So this was done by many students. Also if you go to, I'll just go to another GeoGebra file. So again, this is sin x. So what we have done is, how will we get the derivative of this function? How do you think the, how do you think we can trace the derivative? If we had to trace the derivative, what would we be required to do? Did you have a tangent along the curve? So what point would trace the derivative? So suppose the tangent is here, right? Now I move the point A somewhere here, the tangent will also change. What will change? The slope of the tangent will change, and the x coordinate of the point A will change. So I take a point P whose coordinates are the x coordinate of the point A and the slope of the tangent at A, wherever A is, and that should trace the cos function. So shall we try? So as I move, so there is a way of tracing a point, the path of a point. So I have kept that on for this. So let's see what is happening as A is moving along sin x. So what has it traced? Cos x. And you can quickly change sin x to some other function. You can make it sin 2x and see now what would be the path trace. And you can quickly wipe out that trace by just shifting this. And so the important thing was to understand the point P which will trace the derivative will have x coordinate as the x coordinate of A and the y coordinate as the slope of the tangent at that point. So for example, if you quickly wanted to, so I'll just show it on the slide here. So quickly, if you wanted to do it for the cubic function, the red graph, and you move the tangent, the green line is the tangent along the graph, what would be traced is 3x square. So this is also a good, so you can give a set of many functions for the student to explore. That is on GeoGebra, but even on a graphics calculator, students have plotted functions and their derivatives and tried to get a general sense of the shape of the graphs, and that was also helpful. Situations when derivative does not exist. So looking at when there's a vertical line, say if you look at f of x is x minus 2 raised to the power 1 upon 3 at x equal to 2, at corners, and if this function at x equal to minus 3 and 3, where derivative, of course they have, they did work out the method. So what method do you tell the students? They work out the left hand and the right hand derivatives, and but this is a visual way of looking at it. And also these kind of graphs, x sine 1 upon x and x square sine 1 upon x, where there were no derivatives. So if we look at our students to interpret graphs, that is a very important to develop their flexibility in thinking. Now in a study, students were, this was a graph given and there was a tangent drawn to the graph at the point A. So this is that point. And they were asked that what is f of 1 and what is f dash 1. Just looking at the graph, can you tell? So what is f of 1? Sorry? 2. So you can just read off the y coordinate. But students went to the extent of writing the equation of the line and then substituted the value of 1 and did things like that. So that shows the dependence on procedural. We train them to think procedurally so much that they can't see things when they're obvious. And for f dash 1, what do you need to do? You just need to calculate a and b are given on the tangent line and take the slope. That's all. So the students actually went, they thought that they had to write the equation of the line and take its derivative and then find f dash 1. And that is because of the emphasis on procedural methods. If you look, want to look at the mean value theorem, we can, so this is a simple cubic function, and you can just again move, it's very simple to create this animation. You can move this point along the graph. And the good thing about GeoGebra is it shows the slope triangle also. So when there's a point here where the slope triangles are identical and the tangent is parallel to the secant joining the two points A and B. And when you bring it to the other side also, there is the other point. So it's a simple, and you can, the thing about this, once you've created this animation, you just need to keep changing fx, the function, if you want them to explore 5 or 6 different exercises. Now, can I have some thoughts of yours on this? To understand the relationship between a function, its derivative and the second derivative, is it possible to identify which one is which from the graph? And of course, with the reasoning. So these 1, 2, 3, which of these options would be the correct? And how do we decide that? Any wild guesses? What should 3 be? Okay, you can do hit and trial. You can assume that one of them is f and try and see the other two are fitting the characteristics or not. But if you look at 3, as suppose 3 was f, the dotted graph. Sorry? Did someone say something? Yeah, so if 3 is the actual graph, is it possible that 3 is the actual graph? Then in case if 3 is the actual graph, which should be the derivative function? Is that a guess or there's a reason? What's the reason? See, because this is decreasing, right? And then it is increasing beyond this. So what do we have on the dotted graph here? A point of? Is it a point of inflection? So would this describe, so f dash x is negative here and then becomes positive here. So does that explain? So if the dotted graph is the actual function, then this lighter one, the 2, could be the derivative. Then does it justify that 1 is the second derivative? I mean, is this the derivative of this one? So like here there is a, if you take this as the original as some function, so this has a local maxima here. So the derivative is cutting the graph at the x-axis here. And at the other point there is a local minima here. So this justifies it. So the dotted graph should be f, 2 should be f dash x, and the derivative of that should be the thick one. So these are things should be given for thinking to students, because this will enhance their graphical thinking and understanding. Or something like this, where there are 5 points, at which of the 5 points are both these negative? And so what do we need to see for the derivative to be negative and the second? First, this derivative has to be negative. So which points do you think would qualify for that? Yes, see, which point? At B, if you take the slope of the tangent at B, would it have a negative slope? Okay, and then its second derivative would, the second derivative of that, so what would need to be done is you would have to roughly trace out the derivative graph, derivative function for this, and then look at where that would also have a negative slope for the tangent. In fact, B is the answer. B is out of the 5 which have. So give these kind of problems to students to think. So I'm not using any technology here, but what I'm saying is that when graphing is required, you can use the tools, but you can also bring in such questions, because once they start playing with graphs, it will become natural for them to think about these kind of questions. Now I had a go when I used to be a teacher not so long ago. I used to have students having a lot of problems with the questions on application of derivatives. Now you know those standard questions which are there in the NCERT textbook. And they would have a problem with the procedural part, how to solve the first derivative equated to 0, second derivative equated to 0, and they would get wrong solutions and then everything would go wrong. And 6-mark question, they would get 2 out of 6. That was in the CBSE exam. So now I tried a thing that, okay, then they were very anxious about that particular topic. So I said, okay, fine, I'll give you a tool. You use the first tool which I showed you, which has a calculator with a CAS enabled in it, and you try 5 or 6 of these different questions. So people say that when you use a calculator, you stop thinking. Okay, let's challenge that. Suppose this is the question. This is that same question that there is a rectangular sheet of paper, squares have. You are all familiar with that question. And what should be the length of the square cut out so that the volume is maximum, right? Now, so I said, okay, the tool will do all the calculations for you, but you will have to solve the question yourself, which means, so they used the class pad. So they figured out that this is the volume of the box because it's a 15 by 8. So when you fold up the sides, the height of the box is x, 15 minus 2x and 8 minus 2x are the. And so they had to write this. So if that went wrong, then their question would end. So they had to do the thinking part and tell the calculator what to do. Calculator can't think on its own. So then they say differentiate this with respect to x, they got this, equated to 0, and the calculator gives 2 values. Rejected 6 because the width of the paper doesn't allow you to cut a square of side 6. So then immediately the graphing feature is there, so they had to just use a stylus to drag the thing and there is a graph. So it's a cubic function. They were happy. Now what is at x equal to 5 by 3, what is happening? So is it a local maxima and all that? So all this is the calculation part. Then they went to the second derivative, substituted x equal to 5 by 3. They applied the second derivative test basically, which they would have done on paper and pencil. They were expected to do on paper and pencil in the traditional class. Here they were doing it on the tool, but they were doing all the thinking. So finally the maximum volume came out to be this, right? Now, how did it enhance graphical understanding? So they graphed this part of the cubic function. Here at x equal to 1.65 upon 3, there is a maximum. This is the maximum volume. And they had to relate it to the first derivative. So the first derivative was plotted. So they said, yes, yes, it will be a parabola because this is a cubic. So the first derivative will now be a parabola. So here comes the parabola. And wherever this cuts the x-axis, corresponding to that is the point of maxima, local maxima. And that is the value. So they could make these graphical linkages, which the other students who were traditionally solving were not able to do without the use of. This is not really any formal research study, but after solving 5 or 6 questions using the tools, the students were enthused to say, okay, I mean, we've understood the main thing, now it is only the calculation part which we now have to address. So they went back and looked at those things. So this had a very positive impact on their approach to that particular kind of problems. Integrals, you find students, they talk about the reverse power rule. And they say we add 1 to the exponent and divide by the new exponent, and this is what they understand for power. But when it comes, when they have to apply the rule to negative or fractional powers, then they often make mistakes, right? And also, if you ask them to integrate this, they will say k square upon 2, and these errors do come up in the class. So how do we enhance the visual understanding about the integral? How do you address the integral in the class, the definite integral? Do you do integral as a limit of sums? Yes, that is a part of. So they have to combine the areas of the rectangles and evaluate that. Okay, now again another question. Now here this is a graphic calculator output, but that's okay. I just want to emphasize that this is a straight line which cuts at 1, 0 and this is 0, 1. Okay, now I'm saying that this is f dash x. So what is fx? So it's given that you look only in 0 to 2. This is 0, this is 1, this is 2. And it is given that f of 0 is 0. So now it's a reversibility in their thinking. So given f dash x, what is fx? Now you want them to give a roughly trace out the graph. What fx would look like. What do you think the first things your student would say, suppose you gave them this question? Now they are familiar with that the derivative of a quadratic is linear and those kind of things. Are they familiar? Yes. So would they be able to say something about fx if this is f dash x? Sorry? So they would say it might be a parabola. Okay. What else is known from the graph? One is that the parabola should pass through origin. That is already given. Fine. What else? If this f dash x passes through this point, so what does that indicate? And it is going from negative to, f dash x is going from negative to positive as it passes through x equal to 1. What does that imply? Yes. What kind? Is it a... So would the parabola be upward opening or downward opening? Rather, would the parabola have a minimum at x equal to 1 or maximum? Sorry? It would be inverted? But the derivative is going negative to positive. So it is decreasing before 1 and increasing after 1. So it should be an upward opening. Yes, if it was the other way, yes, you are right. Now, okay, so now we know it's an upward opening, it passes through 0, 0, right? But I need to sketch that, so I need something else. What would be the minimum value? It has a minimum at x equal to 1, but what would be that minimum value? Is it possible to gauge that from the graph? So we know that it has a minimum. Do you agree with this? See, this area of this triangle actually gives the value of the function at x equal to 1. And what would be the area of this triangle? This is 1 and this is also 1. It's the ratio is not the same on both the axes, but both are 1. So area of this triangle would be half, but it is below the x axis. So the vertex of that parabola would be 1 comma minus half. And it passes through 0, 0 and it is an upward opening. So now they get a fair idea of the function and they can graph it. And they of course know that f is quadratic since f dash is linear. So we need to blend the visual and analytical thinking to actually develop the graph of f. So if you want them to visualize things like, let's quickly look at. So in GeoGebra it's very simple to do this. I have a cubic function minus x cube plus 2x square plus 1 and I can ask GeoGebra to create the lower sums, the lower rectangles and the upper rectangles, and I can number of rectangles can be varied by means of a slider. So as I do that, so what is, and of course I take from between 0 and 2, so area under the curve. So dynamically you see in the, this is the algebra view, this is the geometry view, and in the algebra view it says the lower sum, it is changing, right? Do you see that? So it is changing and it is something like 4.28, and simultaneously the upper sum is also. So I have taken the number of rectangles ranging from 1 to 50. So what is happening? They are close but obviously not very close. And you can then ask them, ask students to explore a bit by changing the range of values of the slider from say 1 to 100. So it's 1 to 100, right? So as I move, now the difference has reduced between the lower sum and the upper sum, and you can keep doing that. So this also helps to visualize. And we do, you do questions like this where they have to evaluate the area between two curves, right? So in this, one good way of asking this kind of a question could be that what is the area between these two curves? So first of all, you could ask them, what are the inequations which would lead to this shaded region? Number one, and can we find the area of that shaded region using integration? So now again, I had to generate these sort of graphics calculators. I'll just explain. These are the ticks 1, 2, 3 and so on, and the same on the y-axis. They are not marked. But if you look at this parabola, what do you think is the equation of this parabola? X square? No, if you just look at this one. If it was here, it would be x square, but it is 2 units below. So it would be y is equal to x square minus 2. Agree? Okay. Now look at this downward facing parabola. Okay. So there is a shift. If it was at this, if it was at the origin here, so it has shifted by 1 unit to the left and 2 units above. Do you see that? The vertex of this, had this parabola had the vertex at the origin, it has shifted 1 unit to the left and 2 units above. Can we use that information to guess what would be the equation of this parabola? So it would have y is equal to minus of x plus 1 whole square. Okay. But it is shifted 2 units to the, it's a vertical shift, so it should be 2 minus x plus 1 whole square. So we know, please, you have got the two, I would request you to do this. So you have the two equations, right? You have y is, what was the other one? y is equal to x square minus 2, and the other, the second one is y is equal to 2 minus x plus 1 the whole square. Okay, but what would be the inequations if you had to get this graph? How would you generate this for your students? I mean, you would have to tell the graphics calculator that either it's greater than equal to or less than equal to or whatever, right? So what would be the way to go about it? You could choose a reference point and see which inequality is satisfied. So yes, see, graphics calculator will generate the shaded region. Okay, so maybe I'll just show you, because I also wanted to show you what it looks like. So this is the soft form of the graphics calculator. Now if you notice, I've entered the actual inequations, but I had to figure it out. So it is actually y greater than equal to x minus 2 holds, x square minus 2, and y less than equal to the other one. The reason being, you can take a reference point and check. So I need to select these two. So what the students would have is the actual calculator in their hands. This is just a demonstration version. Shall I draw now? So okay, so we can't see this. So right, this is your graph, the shaded region. Now we want the area of this. Okay. So in using integration, how do we help them find the area? So I suggest that let's shift the graph upwards by 2 units. Does it change the area? No. Okay. But the equations would change, no? What would they change to? Now, this parabola shifted by 2 units, so it becomes y is equal to x square. The other one was also shifted by 2 units, so it has become 4 minus x plus 1 whole square. Okay. Now you need to find the points of intersection of these two and take the area under the upper parabola minus the area under the lower one. You can do that, of course, by hand, but since I am trying. So I have a command on the calculator which tells me that, okay, or maybe I should show you that one. Right? So let me see if this is possible. Yes. So I'm selecting these two expressions now, but I have removed the shaded region because the calculator cannot identify the points of intersection on a shaded region. There are limitations, of course, in any tool. Do you see this? Now I have the two parabolas which have been shifted up by 2 units. And now I quickly say, look, give me the points of intersection. It immediately gives me x coordinate as, I mean, the for the point of intersection, the x coordinate is what? Minus 1.82 something. And I use the, what is the other one? Right? So now you know what you have to do. So we have to integrate from this point to this value of x, which I do again using the calculator. Now, as a teacher, you have to reflect what is wrong in doing this. Is there something wrong in doing it this way, if you had the tool? Okay, so here the calculator can do definite integration, and you enter the expression here, and so you find the area under the upper curve, the downward facing curve, which is downward parabola, which is this, and you subtract the area under the other one, which comes out to be this, or the difference between the two would give you the area of the shaded region. So these are tasks you can give students, and you can give few extra ones, because the calculation part is taken over by the calculator, but at least they are visualizing and they are deciding what is to be done, right? Okay, now if you look at the fundamental theorem calculus, and when we say things like suppose f is continuous on a closed interval a b and g is defined by this, it is a little difficult for the students to understand what this really means. And they are not able to work with functions which are defined in terms of integrals. And then we say that this then g is the antiderivative of f on a b, and if f is any antiderivative, then we have this, right? This is what it says. So is it possible to get students to actually see the area function and how it can? So again, we can go to a GeoGebra file. Okay, so here I have a very simple function, it's a linear function, fx is 6 minus x. And I have a slider which will vary the area. So that means I actually start exploring this from the interval 2 to something, 2 onwards. And so when I shift the slider to 2, I'll just remove the trace right now. So what is happening when x when the value of the x c is basically the value of the x coordinate which you are varying by moving this blue line across under the curve, right? So as this blue line is moving under this line, some area will be generated, right? So we want to see how that area varies with the x coordinate. So when we do that, so I am tracing a point, just as in the derivative. There I traced a point whose x coordinate was the value of the point on the curve and the slope of the line was the y coordinate. Here, the x coordinate is the c, which is the on the x axis, and the y coordinate is the value of the area. Okay. So what is, do you see what the points are coming up? Where do you think they are going? What kind of shape do you think will come up? So the area is increasing, so the points are going up, increasing at a somewhat decreasing rate. And when it comes to 6, there seems to be, and after that what will happen? Now notice the value of the area is also showing here, 8, of the triangle basically, but now it will get subtracted from that because it is, the area is now coming below. And the antiderivative function is being generated. So this, and of course you can do it for a more complex functions which are difficult to, so I have for example taken sine of x square plus 3x minus 1. Yes. Yes, yes, the triangle, yes, exactly, exactly that. So now look at this, for example. This is sine of x square minus 3x plus 1. And when you look at the, so I've taken it from 0 onwards. And so you can now ask them to make linkages between the antiderivative and the actual function. So these linkages become more easily accessible. In fact, it's difficult to do this with paper and pencil unless you are very good in drawing and you have decided on some specific functions, but if the tool is there, there should be no reason as to why not to use it. I think time is almost up, so I'll just wind up in 2 minutes. Okay. Also, when they solve differential equations, now students solve differential equations very procedurally and they know the methods, they learn the methods, but to visualize the solution or the family of curves is often a challenge. So maybe a slope field plotter could be used to show the trends of the curves. So for example, if you have a simple differential equation like this with an initial value given, and if you, this is of course a Mathematica generated, there's a command called stream plot which plots this thing. It gives you the trend, so this will be an exponential curve, a positive and a negative one. So a slope field will only show you small tangent lines which will tell you the direction in which the curve will proceed. So, and for a specific value, say y, so if you say y0 is equal to minus 1, so if you go to that particular point 0 comma minus 1 on this direction plot, you will get the particular curve the specific curve that you are referring to. The solution of the differential equation will be a family of curves. But when you want a specific solution, you can click on that particular point and get that particular solution. So that is also a very helpful. For example, one could do like if you ask students to explore something like the prey-predator model and how they interact with each other. So here there is a nonlinear differential equation and the two species are interacting with each other. So you have the X is the predator species, foxes and rabbits, you can take anything. So if X is the predator and Y is the prey, then the rate of growth of the predator in the absence of the prey, it will decline because there will be no food. But in the presence due to the interaction, it would grow. So there is a minus AX plus BXY, whatever A and B. So you can explore. First of all, the students can explore. I have done this using Mathematica, where you put different values of A, B, C, D and see what kind of plots are generated with different initial conditions. Now, if you take time, and this is the time and versus the populations. So the typical cycles are like this. So fox and rabbits, when rabbits are at a peak, that is also the time when the predator population is growing fast. And you can see the link between the peaks of both the populations. But if you plot the rabbits versus the foxes, you would get some kind of an elliptical trajectory. And that would show very beautifully on the slope field plotter, which I just showed you in the previous slide. You will get multiple such elliptical trajectories and you can take different initial value points and see which trajectory you are looking for. And there are numerous such. These are only just, I've just touched the surface actually. And in fact, there was some student of mine who had explored, class 12 student who had to do a project and explored Fourier series applications using Mathematica and explored what is Gibbs phenomenon basically. So I don't have time. Maybe in the project session, if there is opportunity, then I would like to share. But I would like to say that I would like to show the conclusions of that. So this student explored, actually worked out the integrals, the Fourier coefficients by hand. So there was no technology which helped there. But plotting the partial sums was very helpful using a Mathematica simple code. So I'm just showing you that. So this was for the function, for the constant function 1. And this is the function value and this is the partial sums of the Fourier series. So when the partial sums of, this is sine of 2n plus 1 x upon 2n plus 1. And you are varying basically the number of terms of the partial sum. So as you go on increasing, you see that it approximates the function well in between, but there are overshoots towards the end and then they calculate the values of the overshoots and some conclusions were drawn. But the whole point is that because of technology, the student got access to, could explore, because otherwise he would have just calculated the Fourier coefficients and not known what to do with it after that. But could visualize them and calculated the values of the highest peaks and what was happening. So we see that it approaches the discontinuity. And if you want to explore the square wave function, that also looks very nice. As you go on increasing the partial sums, what happens? And there are various applications of Gibbs phenomenon. So I would like to conclude by saying that technology can often act as an amplifier by giving students access to higher level concepts and giving you possibilities of a range of kinds of questions that you can ask in the class. It facilitates the computational process also. So if there are some very tedious calculations, the technology can take over that. But you will find, and I have found rather, that when students, it's not that they don't want to do things on paper and pencil anymore. There is very much a tendency of doing things on paper and pencil and also trying to verify using the technology. So it's almost like that technology is an assistant sitting there trying to give inputs to the student. And when the technology is giving a different unexpected answer, then they try to justify why is the Mathematica answer different. I got this, in fact, with partial fractions, there was a very interesting case where Mathematica was giving a different output and the student got a different, and then they tried to modify the Mathematica output to get it to the one and see the equivalence of both. So it is technology can help you think in different directions. We can't think of it on paper and pencil, how that happens. It can serve as a mathematical investigation assistant, giving students control over what they are learning. So they become more in charge of what they are learning, and definitely provides a rich and motivating environment to explore the problem at hand. In this particular case, it was that of the Fourier series. And I would just like to end with this quote. So thank you very much. If there are any questions, on what you've seen. I mean, probably it seemed like one after the other, a lot of things, but broadly, I mean, do you feel this approach would help, or in would it augment what you are already doing in the class? Or anyway, we can maybe discuss it over a later time.